Hello, we are live, and our guest tonight is handwriting expert Kate Gladstone, and this time she's going to share with us some songs about scribes. Hello, Kate.
Yes, about scribes, the scribal arts, calligraphy, and tonight these will not be my songs, but will be the songs of someone I knew very, very slightly before his death back around. He actually died about 8 years ago. His name was Bill Hildebrandt, William J. Hildebrandt, if you're being formal. And if you want details in his life, you can look up his obituary, although I'll tell you a few things. I can't recall at the moment if he died in 2013 or 2015. But in any case, this book was one I almost showed off when we were doing the segment on handwritten books in the modern age, because this, like the books that I did show, is actually photo reproduction of his handwriting, not a line of type in it. This is all his lettering, and not just the title page, but inside. I might show you some things from inside, and of course you'll see a few little clips of a line or two, but I might, at one point, I might show you one or two things, and you'll think it's a font, but it's not. In fact, here is actually his autograph, you know, not very, somewhat calligraphic.
Oh.
And his nice little doodle of a singing guy with, you know, big eyes and a mustache that he used to a caricature. And you can see, although here, of course, is his formal writing, his calligraphy, and is a more formal doodle. You can, you know, you can see the similarity. It is the same. And yes, this is not a font, even though you might need a magnifying glass to see that it's not a font. In fact, he actually has his introduction is his handwriting. The copyright notice is his handwriting. You can take a close up. Now that's pretty, you know, that's pretty good. And well, these are songs that he actually sang at meetings of calligraphy clubs and at calligraphy conferences. There are various groups, local, national, international, that have, you know.
Katrina is here, and she has a comment, although I'm not sure. I guess that's that picture. Is that his self-image?
The only comment I see is everyone can see and hear you, and I certainly hope so. Is there a way to get the spear carrier? Is there a way to get spear carrier's comment on the screen?
It is on the screen right now.
All I see is, oh, it's a little face. That's a comment. Well, that's so cute. There's an odd resemblance to his little doodle. From this, it won't surprise you that one of his books was about calligraphic flourishing. And you see, he did this. And
she says it was just supposed to be a pair of eyes.
Yes, exactly. Well, it's very cute. And I hope to have a feast for the ears as well as for the eyes. Certainly won't be singing everything in the book. Aya will be kind enough, I know, to put sometimes the first line or two of lyrics on screen. No more than that, because we don't want to get copyright smitten by YouTube. But we do have some links to, this is where you can buy it on Amazon when it's in, and it hardly ever is. This was printed once in 1987 in a very limited run. I'm fortunate enough to have an autographed copy. I've had other copies, which, well, one was lost when I moved, one was lost to a basement flood. So I, you know, when I saw that it's on sale, I snagged it. eBay will tell you that they have it for $3.75. But if you go to eBay, don't go, because when you get there, they'll say out of stock. And it's been out of stock there for years. You used to be able to get it on Amazon. Now it's out of stock. But, you know, enough talking about some of the songs that he sang. Now I'm going to turn my tablet sideways so I can get a larger, you know, and we have some. Okay, now we have some of these. Now this one was actually near the end of the book, but I put it at the beginning as a sort of introduction. And you see, for each one that I'm doing, I'm having a few lines. At some point I might show some of, you know, I might hold up and show some of them in full. Sometimes I have just the title and the phrase, because some of these songs are really short. This is moderate length, and I think this will make a great introduction. Hail, hail, the calligraphers are here, which he wrote to basically honor the calligraphy conference scene. And he is very careful. He always was very careful about copyright. He wrote these poems and he would say, maybe sung to the tune of, you know, to keep his bases covered. So yeah, let's launch. Hail, hail, the calligraphers are here. Once a year they caper with lots of ink and paper. Hail, hail, the calligraphers are here. What the heck do we care now? And if you want to join in at home, I won't hear you, but I'd love to know if you're doing it. Hail, hail, the gilders are here with gold leaf and with gesso, making quite a mess. Oh, hail, hail, the gilders are here. What the heck do we care now? Hail, hail, the pen twisters are here. The twisting left and right is what gives us all bursitis. Hail, hail, the pen twisters are here. What the heck do we care now? Hail, hail, the paleographers are here. They will stay up all night measuring an X height. Hail, hail, the paleographers are here. What the heck do we care now? Hail, hail, the purists are here. No matter what you tell them, they insist on quills and vellum. Hail, hail, the purists are here. What the heck do we care now? And I'm hoping that this will be a good intro to help get people in the spirit. Now, I'd like to start with something to a tune that many people think is a folk song tune, but it actually is a 19th century tune. Let's curl up and we can do Grandfather's Pen. How about that? Would you be willing? I wanted to put these mostly in order if we could. If we could go other than I thought that this one, which was at the end of the book, I thought made a better beginning. But we see we've got a lot of stuff and I arranged it in order so we could have a sequence, you know, call this, you know, okay, evening, so having
the next
fun.
One is the,
that's the second. That's right at the top of the screen. Okay, there we go. It didn't show the top line. I had trouble aligning the graphics, but that's okay.
Okay.
Are you ready? And if you know my grandfather's clock, you can sing along at home. My grandfather's pen was too long for his den, so it wrote on the living room floor. It was taller than half by half than the old man, but then, oh, it's writing he really adored. It could write every hand from those strange and foreign lands, and was always his treasure and pride. But it stopped short, never to write again when the old man died. 90 years it was flourishing, stroke, 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 his soul it was nourishing, stroke, 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 but it stopped short, never to write again when the old man died. And yes, Bill Hildebrandt did die quite old, in his 80s, as I recall. Oh, he'd take it to workshops and take it to school, and they'd always make fun of its size. But when it started to write, why, it was quite a sight, and its gracefulness opened their eyes. Yes, the Gothics and Uncials it wrote without a flaw, and its flourishes really would glide. But it stopped short, never to write again when the old man died. And now, before I can continue, I should point out for those who are not in the know that this may be a bit of authorial self-insertion, because Bill Hildebrandt had 3 patents in his life, U.S. patents, and one of them was for a very giant demonstrator pen that he designed and would take to workshop, and it looked like a pen, you know, that you would make for a giant. It was immense. It was something like,
photo of that? That would be lovely to see.
It would be. I would say, now, I may look for it. It was known technically as the Whopper plate, a combination of Whopper and copper plate. There are still some calligraphy stores that sell it. I don't know if they're selling new old stock or if this is some kind of replica, but if you wanted to find out about it, you'd be well advised either to put the word Whopper plate as one word into Google or Bing or whatever is your favorite search engine, or to write to his old guild, his old calligraphy club, where he was very prominent, the Connecticut Valley Calligraphers. And you can Google them. I don't have the link handy, but they are still in business, and I understand he's remembered very fondly. So I like to think that, I don't know when he wrote this song, but I think in some ways this song is a self-portrait. And what could he do? Well, he designed this pen for copperplate style, but it could write out italic and Roman caps too, and it never would scratch or would blot. It would never leave out any word from the text and would put in each comma and dot. It could make letters short or could make them rather tall. And well, that's actually not the one, the Whopper pen. If you're looking for a Whopper plate written as one word.
Oh.
Or could make them rather tall and could write them quite narrow or wide. But it stopped short, never to go right again when the old man died. And there you actually have the Whopper plate. Last verse. Oh, it still wrote with pride on the night Grandpa died, though its ink supply was running low. It wrote out the colophon to Grandpa's life with a flourish above and below. When it ran out of ink, then my grandpa gave a wink, and he closed up his tired old eyes. Then it stopped short, never to write again, and the old man died. Now, for those who don't know what a colophon is, and if you want to look it up, it's C-O-L-O-P-H-O-N. That is the technical term for the little decorative drawing or paragraph that is sometimes done at the end of a book, especially a luxury book. Here is, for instance, the colophon to this book, which is a rather long paragraph that he wrote in the form of a diminishing triangle. And people have done other things, little drawings, you know, little doodles, word puzzles, all sorts of things. If you've seen printed books from certain presses, you know, they will have little penguins or dolphins on the back page. Well, that's a colophon, and you've seen these all your life and you never knew it. So now you have learned something. And of course, there were colophons certainly in handwriting in
Are you there?
Before it was a printed, you know, a printer. Now, I am certainly here. And I hope the rest of you are too. Do we have any more comments out in the,
I just thought maybe you would want to show the colophon again.
In fact, I will not only, I will show it, but not only that, I will read it because he's got a little, well, I'll tell you what, let me put it up. I want to put it so you can read it. If you read the whole thing, you'll see that there is a very subtle authorial joke buried in there, where he's sort of cocking his snoot at the world of limited editions of books, even though this was one.
I see. This booklet was designed and written out using an assortment of pens by the author. It was printed on Mohawk superfine smooth stock by the Meriden Steinauer Press. Of this first edition, there were only 1,000 copies printed, and this is copy number one.
But don't be too impressed. Keep on reading.
NB. A number of people have asked for the first copy off the press since it is not possible to satisfy everyone. And to be fair to all, each copy has been numbered one personally by the author on the original artwork, of course.
So I won't know what copy this really is. I know that some of his papers are archived in various libraries, probably in the Connecticut Valley Calligraphers Guild Library and possibly in some others. I've never been there. I would love to spend my life hunting down archives, but I don't have the time. And, I didn't have the time when I was younger, and I sure don't now. I'm 59. But
that's still young.
Well, anyway, not everyone loves calligraphers, by the way, as much as calligraphers love calligraphers. And I'll give you an example of this to a tune that everyone thinks they know the words to, but if you look up the original words, you'll realize that you do not know the words because they're full of 19th century references that make no sense now. So look up the words sometime and hum that tune as you hear what was written in the modern day to the words of a man on the flying trapeze. We have that scribe and his damned ABCs. I don't know if I included it, but I always thought that this one is too much. Yep, we got it.
Yeah.
Once I was happy, but now I'm forlorn, like an old manuscript tattered and torn, left in this wide world to fret and to mourn, betrayed by a maid in her teens. Now this girl that I loved, she was handsome, and I tried all I knew her to please. But I never could please her one quarter so well as that scribe with his damned ABCs. Oh, his pen floats across the page with the greatest of ease. This daring young scribe with his damned ABCs. His italic is graceful, all the girls he does please. And my love he has stolen away. He'd play with a flourish like a cat with a mouse. With his eyes he'd caress every girl in the house. Perhaps he is better described as a louse, but his clients all paid just the same. He'd flourish their names for them just for the show. And one night he did one for my love. As he stroked the italic, she shouted, "Bravo!" Then he swashed the ascenders above. Ooh, his pen floats across the page. The daring young scribe with his damned ABCs. His italic is graceful. All the girls he does please, and my love he has stolen away. One night to his studio he invited her in. He plied her with gold leaf and gesso and gin and started her off on the road to ruin. Alas, and alack, and italic. Well, he gave her a pen and a bottle of ink and he taught her some uncials to boot. Now she spends all her time with calligraphy freaks. And for me, she does not give a hoot. Oh, his pen floats across the page with the greatest of ease. This daring young scribe with his damned ABCs. His italic is graceful. All the girls he does please, and my love he has stolen away. Some months after that, I went into a hall. And to my surprise, I found there on the wall a calligraphed poster that did my heart gall. It said she was now working for him. Well, he taught her calligraphy, gilding and such, and how to charge clients high fees. Made her sign an agreement to work just for him. Now she writes all his damned ABCs. Her pen floats across the page with the greatest of ease. That daring young maid with her damned ABCs. She does all the work while he sits back at ease. And that's what's become of my love.
I love that.
Now, the next two that I'd like to do are so short and so simple that I decided to make those into a little intellectual puzzle before we sing them. These are two rounds. If you scroll down, let's get one. What I'd like to do is I'm going to get them both on the screen, and these are two separate songs. Before we even try to do them as a round, which I probably won't do because I'm totally, totally bad at rounds, what I'm going to do is sing the first two lines of each of these little four-line ditties. And I want you out there in YouTube land to see, can you extrapolate what will be the last two lines, the next two, in other words, the last two of each. In other words, this is not name that tune, but write that song. Let's see if you can do it, because some people say parodies are obvious. But let's go back, if you will. So let's start with, I'm going to sing it, and I'd like you, Ayah, to guess, and we'll see if anyone listening Are you writing? Are you writing? Fellow scribe. Now, what lyrics do you think might come next, Ayah, if you had to concoct them?
What are you composing? What are you composing?
Well, that would be an excellent third line. It wasn't his, but it's excellent. Too bad you and he could never have met. You know, maybe you and I should do a calligraphy song or an alphabet or writing system related song album. We could do it, and we could definitely do it, you know, and we should do it together. But I'll tell you what he really came up with. Listen to the singing of your pen, of your pen. Wonderful song. And, you know, many calligraphers and a lot of the better handwriting teachers, when they're teaching someone to write, they'll say, you want to hold this pen gently enough that you could hear and feel it sing and not grit on the paper. You know, some people have, you know, more of a problem with this than others, particularly if they're unused to dip pens or even fountain pens because they've been writing, you know, with ballpoints and rollerballs and so on all their life. It can be very hard to hold a pen so that it doesn't grit against the paper. And I don't know about my students, but I can just hear it going, ouch! And I will tell you that I have heard from many teachers alive and now dead that the singing is there if you listen to it. And sometimes I think I can hear it. Sometimes not. Now, here's the next one. And since this is really only two long lines, all I can do is sing one and see if you can come up with the rest. Write your page gently to the end. What do you think might follow?
Happily. I don't know.
You're close. Well, what he came up with was, merrily, 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 letters are my friends.
Oh, okay, nice.
Yeah, I wanted to include these so that people could learn them, but they were so short that my only way to include just part of them and not get copyright smitten, copyright struck, whatever is the term, copyright stricken, was to fragment them.
Well, you know, actually, merrily, merrily, merrily is from the original, and I don't
that
believe
is. That. A lot of parodies will stick towards the original. If you've heard some of the parodies I've done, including non-calligraphic parodies I've done with people like Leslie Fish, you remember when I did that Dr. Handwriting song?
Yes.
About 1 in 5 of those lines were directly from her original, and either I had to change no word or change only 1 or 2 words.
That's perfectly fine. I'm just saying that there shouldn't be any copyright strike for using such an old song that whose words are already out of copyright.
I wonder how old it is actually. And of course, by the way, I'm sure that in the description to the song, speaking of what's old and what's not, I'm sure that you will be adding the copper, you know, the Whopper plate link. Now, I'm wondering, you know, everything in the world seems to be on, you know, Wikipedia. I mean, Jell-O is on Wikipedia. I'm wondering if Row, Row, Row Your Boat is on Wikipedia, because there might very well, I have never really thought about it. You know, like many people, I learned that song when I was about 2, and I'm actually wondering if there must be somewhere a first attested written version, because there is of everything. I mean, I was very surprised to find that there is a written version, like the earliest written version of, you know, another nursery rhyme. 1, 2, buckle your shoe is back in, you know, in basically early modern English times. So I wonder how old is Row, Row. Now, let me see if I can expand this. They got the lyrics. They got the melody. Okay. I mean, Bing Crosby has it, but it's older. It has a folk song index number. I mean, come on. This is much older than Bing Crosby. If you scroll down, normally when they do Wikipedia and songs, they do the early history.
They have an 1852.
Surprised. It has the lyrics have a very 19th century feel. I have to tell you, even though I like the tune, I think it's a cute song, I always hated having to sing it myself. At one point, when I was in first grade, we had a music hour, and it seemed the teacher was like always picking that one as one of the first. I didn't like it because I basically would try to get away with singing "Life Is Not a Dream" for what it's worth.
Yeah, that's fine.
My teacher didn't think it was Mrs. Gilman. The music teacher didn't think it was fine. She thought I was making fun of the song. I wasn't. I was just saying, you know, I disagreed with the song. Look, I probably should have sung what the composer, you know, said to sing, but I just couldn't stand this. Anyway.
Yeah. Do you know the name of the composer?
I do not know the name. Does anyone know the name of it?
Eliphalet Orem Lyle.
You know, I've actually heard of him, but not as the author. He was an English textbook author, which is how I know of him. I had no idea that he wrote this too. Although it sounds like the kind of thing he would write, you know, it's the kind of thing you write to teach something to children.
Yes, but it is around, and I did want to talk about that for a moment because, you know, next week,
yes,
we are going to be doing the rondo, and the rondo, while it's not exactly around, has a name whose etymology is just like round, isn't it?
Oh, definitely. And certainly the forms are connected in some way. As I warned you, we're absolutely terrible at rounds, which is the other reason Mrs. Gilman, the first grade music teacher, hated me. I always come in at the wrong part. I always get confused listening and not knowing which tune I'm supposed to be hearing when. So I will do my best. But it seemed there were, I mean, Mrs. Gilman, was obsessed with rounds.
I don't know how you can do it, Kate, without an extra person because
we can't unless
two voices.
Yeah,
right?
I'd have to clone myself. So I guess, you know, that's one reason I was hoping Julia could come in, but yeah. Since she didn't, let's go to something that's not around. Let's go to more solo stuff. Okay. And by the way, this one, many of you know, Don't Fence Me In. This will be Don't Take My Quills. So those who know the song, you know the chorus line for this song, and if you want to come join in at home, I won't hear you, but you will hear yourselves. Oh, give me pens, lots of pens, and some ink to dip them in. Don't take my quills. Give me paper or vellum or parchment by the skin. Don't take my quills. Let me write by myself in the evening hours and decorate my page with pretty vines and flowers. I don't need those castles or those ivory towers. Don't take my quills. Oh, when I get my hands on an alphabet, I don't ever let it go. And you can bet I ain't seen a letter yet that I don't want to know. That's really so. So let me be by myself in my scriptorium. All those letters in my head I want to free them. Give me sheets of vellum and I'll ABC them. Don't take my quills. Let's see.
Very nice.
Okay.
I wonder about are there any songs about brushes? Because I know that in China, calligraphy brushes are a very big thing.
There probably are. I don't happen to know them. And certainly there have been many, many Western scribes also who used brushes. There's actually evidence that, believe it or not, the Roman stone inscriptions, you know, these classical things that we see on those columns and statues, that they were painted before they were carved out and then repainted. And some details of the technique suggest that they were done with straight cross-cut brushes, similar to the show card brushes used by modern sign paper painters. Now, not everyone accepts this theory. And if you want to know more about it, all you have to do is find $60 to $80 you're not using and go onto the internet and see if you can get a reprinted copy of a big, big fat book called The Origin of the Serif, which is actually about a lot more than that. And it's about how some of the details in modern Western letter forms and some others came to be. And since the author was actually someone who had a triple career as a calligrapher, sign painter, and Roman Catholic priest,
priest, he had a lot to say about Rome because he became one of the experts on Roman paleography. I never met him, although I've met many students of his. But this is a fellow you can look up, a Father Edward Catich, C-A-T-I-C-H, who actually started a calligraphy and handwriting major at St. Ambrose University in Davenport, Iowa.
And can you tell me his name again, please?
Catich, C-A-T-I-C-H. And you can look him up. And he wrote some marvelous books, and I think he was on target about a lot of things. I mean, even though he was, you know, part of a priestly order, I forget the details. I'm not, you know, the greatest expert in the world on Catholicism, but when he reached a certain age, this is very interesting, his fellow clerics were so in love with his handwriting, his calligraphy, that they said, you know, Father, even though all the clerics in our order are buried in the same, you know, are buried in the same cemetery and our tombstones all look exactly like they're all carved to a certain specific pattern, we would like you to design your own in your own handwriting, you know, basically because you're special. But he said, no, he said, I'm not going to do this. You know, why should I stand apart from my brethren? You know, you have to be someone very special if you're in a clerical order and they give you a chance and they ask you to be different and to break the rules. Now, I would not be surprised if he got the Gaudi Award, but anyway,
I would love to do a show on him,
but I can do a show on his book, but I never met him. But if we're going, but we could do sort of book of the month shows sometimes, so to speak.
Okay.
Well, anyway, let's go. Our next stop is a sort of epic brag, a modern-day calligrapher. Any Gilbert and Sullivan fans out there? Now, this song does include some name-dropping, some names of persons, places, and things that basically calligraphers would know about that you might not. But since the point of this song is basically one of the typical, see how awesome I am because I do this, I think people will get the gist of it. And besides, it's one of the more fun parodies of a song that was a very fun song to begin with and still is. So is anyone prepared to listen to the tale of an epic brag about someone who is the very model of a modern day calligrapher, which I'm not, but I can sing about it. I know about the pens and inks of ancient scribes and scribblers and how they sharpened up their quills with pen knives and nibblers and how they cured those skins to make that parchment they could write upon and why when they were done, they finished off their books with colophons. I've read the Trajan column and what Catich had to say of it on it. Why, when I was a child in Rome. Now, you're not, I'm only showing the first person. You know that. Why, when I was a child in Rome, I even used to play on it. Oh, how the Romans did those letters may still be a mystery, but when I finish with my research, all that will be history. Oh, ask me about Osmer Wright and Browser, well, I've tried them all. Yes, pens of all descriptions I have stacked about there in the hall. I even have some brushes that are made of Bengal tiger fur. Yes, I'm the very model of a modern-day calligrapher, and he didn't... And Bill did not write the course, you would like to throw it in. Yeah, you are the very model of, you are the very model of a modern-day calligrapher. I've made my own vermilion out of mercury and sulfur chips. I've lettered on the sides of cows with day-old avocado dip. I know about the golden mean and how the Greeks discovered it and how the Book of Kells was stolen and how they recovered it. Oh, I can keep my pen nib fixed or twisted with the best of them. And I can stick my gold leaf onto gesso like the rest of them. Yes, I can carve my pens from reeds and bamboo shoots and turkey quills. I've even written fracture with the sharpened of kosher dills. He's even written fracture with the sharpened ends of kosher dills. I grind my ink from Chinese sticks and write it with a feather touch. I've writ on vellum and on parchment, but I don't like leather much. I can write all the scripts there are and all of those there ever were. So I'm the very model of a modern-day calligrapher. Yes, he is the very model of a modern-day calligrapher. I've all the books that Arthur Baker wrote, and that is quite a few. And before long, I think that I myself will try to write a few. I've studied with Von Stone and Drogen, and I'm sure I will again. And I know why Ward Dunham Wells wears his helmet out into the river. I've met before. I've seen Dick Beasley mix up colors that no one has seen before. Oh, I knew Alice when she had two names instead of one, so there. And I've seen Dallin Blackman in his day glow purple underwear. Yes, he's seen Alan Blackman in his day glow purple underwear. Yes, he's seen Alan Blackman in his day glow purple underwear. Yes, he's seen Alan Blackman in his day glow purple underwear. Worked with life. It's so hard to be modest when you're so darn good. I must have heard. Yes, I'm the very model of a modern day calligrapher. Yes, it's so hard to be so modest when you're so darn good. We must have heard. You are the very model of a modern day calligrapher. Now just handle some of the name dropping. Arthur Baker writes a lot of the calligraphy books that come from Dover Press. He also, for what it's worth, wrote books on how to make new models of paper airplanes, and I recommend all his books very highly if you're into either of those pursuits. Mark Van Stone was and is a calligrapher still living. He wrote a lot of wonderful books on medieval scribal practices, how the scribes studied, you know, even in what amounted to scribe school when they started as, you know, little baby novice monks. Now, however, for the past decade or so, he actually has gone into the field of deciphering ancient Mayan. If you Google his name or look for him on YouTube, you will find him talking about the ancient Mayan script and how we are slowly learning to read it. Mark Drogen, another Mark with a C instead of a K that time, wrote, he's probably still alive, some wonderful books for kids and teens and preteens on how to get started. As I recall, one of them was called Yours Truly, King Arthur, and it showed various medieval scripts from periods when various legendary or real figures lived. Ward Dunham is a Vietnam veteran. Still met him 10, 20 years ago. Little guy next to whom Rambo would look like a 10-year-old boy, you're imagining Ward Dunham. He has a wonderful business in calligraphy and making personalized seals in Gothic black letter. He is a Vietnam vet. He basically taught himself calligraphy in Vietnam, plucking native reeds and making his own ink to keep from going crazy, I guess. And he has been known to, you know, wear various military gear. Carl Geyerhofer is a very well-known calligrapher, known to be pretty athletic. What people don't necessarily know about him is that way back in the 60s in Germany, he was the co-author of a book that was written to teach handwriting to people with no arms, because remember, that was when the thalidomide crisis occurred, and lots of kids, about my age, I'm not one of them, thankfully, but lots of children all over the world were born with no arms or no legs. And he actually did write a book in German whose title translates as, you know, writing for armless students. And it's a very nice, plain, wonderful italic model. I think, I don't know if it was ever used for more than that population, but it would have done anyone good. Dick Beasley loves to play, as you might have guessed, with very brilliant, unusual colors. Alice, who goes by that one name, just like Prince or Madonna, was and is a quite famous calligrapher down in New York City, where I grew up, where she was and is a leading light in something called the Society of Scribes, a wonderful group. She was originally known for much of her career as Alice Cook, K-O-E-T-H, but later on she just went and goes by Alice. Alan Blackman, I've never seen. I don't know him very well. I would presume that he likes to wear, you know, brilliant and unconventional outfits. Anyway, I'm not, you know, the model of a world-famous calligrapher, so I don't know. But I will tell you, we can go down, because not all of a calligrapher's life is bragging fun. Go scroll up. Is not all fun and games. Okay, go down a little, and maybe you can get more of it on the screen. I would like if you could zoom out a little. Now, here's an equally epic tale, but this is of the, okay, it looks like I missed one that I should have copied, okay? I wanted to copy one, and I forgot to copy it. It was called Ghost Writers in the Sky.
Oh.
So I'm going to read that. See, that one was, I think, you know, that's after the one that was showing briefly on the screen. We all know writers in the sky. So go down and we've go. Okay, now the point is go down. No, we don't. I must have left it out when I
copied.
Oh, here it is. Yeah, here it is. I'm going to do this because this is fun. And then go to a creepy supernatural one because this is fun supernatural. And then we'll go to a creepy but historically based one. I was working in my studio one dark and stormy night. I looked out of the window, saw a most unearthly sight. From out behind the clouds, there came a golden quill, I swear, a writing letters in the sky, a writing in the air. Letters of gold, letters of old, ghost writers in the sky. I opened up my window and I gazed upon that sight. Those ancient letters written across the sky so late at night. And as I watched, I thought I heard a voice from up above. Said, don't you be afraid, my child. Those letters spell out love. Letters of gold, letters of old. Ghost writers in the sky. The writing stopped. The voice went on so clear and yet so low. Said, I was once a scribe like you down on the earth below. But I am now a spirit, yes, a ghost that will not die in this great scriptorium way up here in the sky. Letters of gold, letters of old, ghost writers in the sky. The scribes of ancient Egypt, ancient Greece, and Rome still write. They form these letters with their golden quills most every night. Oh, Alcuin and Arrighi, even Edward Johnston, too, write messages of peace and love to scribes below like you. Letters of gold, letters of old. Ghost writers in the sky. You have the power in your hand, the power of your pen, to spread the word of love below again and yet again. Oh, use your pen for something more than earning coins of gold, and help unite the world below into one loving fold. Letters of gold, letters of old. Ghost writers in the sky. The voice had stopped. The sky went dark. I went back to my room and sat there at my drawing board in the dark and gathering gloom. Then I lifted up my pen and wrote the words that now you hear, trying to do what I was told that night, so loud and so clear. Letters of gold, letters of old. Ghost writers in the sky. So when you have the opportunity, don't let it pass. Help spread the word of peace and love to every lad and lass. The power of your pen is greater than the sword of hate. When the golden letters come to you, oh, please don't hesitate. Letters of gold, letters of old. Ghost writers in the sky, the sky, the sky. Well, that's modern mythology, which, as people who research the source tune, Ghost Writers in the Sky, will tell you is really old because it comes from, you know, ancient pre-monotheistic pagan stories about ghosts, warriors hunting through the sky all night, as, you know, stories that exist in many cultures. But this is a modern myth and purely made up as far as ghost calligraphers and, you know, in heaven goes. But if you turn back a little, and I'm going to tell you, I would like you to go back even further. I want to get to the top of the page. So go down, 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 down. Now we are going to have some supernatural encounters of the calligraphic kind, unlike the one we just heard, which I decided was more cheerful to start off on if we were doing supernatural stuff. This one is a little scary, creepy, and frankly sectarian. Let us just say it is written from the point of view of a belief that I do not believe in, that neither do you, that many people do, and that was historically believed in. Namely, we all know about the medieval monks tended to be Catholics. And at one point, among the monkish scribes and the nuns, we forget there were nuns too, writing for dear life, they actually had a demon that they jestingly believed in, or some of them may have believed he was real, that on which they blamed all their errors, all the omitted letters, dropped words, the crooked margins, anything that went wrong with what you were copying. And they believed that there was a little demon called Titivolus. Now, Titivolus had not started out as a calligraphy demon. He had originally been a cautionary tale that was told by clerics to younger clerics, to, religious students, and of course to people in general who were praying, that basically when you're praying, don't have a slip of the tongue. Don't leave out a word when you're praying or singing and be careless, because there's a demon whose job is to pick up every sound that you drop, every speech sound, and put them in a bag and gather them for Lucifer, gather them for the devil to increase his kingdom. This is how he earns his living, picking up all the times that you sinned by, mumbling words in your prayers or hurrying through things or skipping lines because you were careless. Well, since writing religious texts was itself held to be a form of prayer, this popular belief or cautionary tale or whatever we may call it actually generalized among those who could write and who wrote religious stuff day in and day out. And we actually have a picture of someone here praying to avoid Titivolus. You can see Titivolus with his great big bag collecting letters, not just sounds, but letters anymore.
Kate, he sounds as if he were the patron saint of scribal errors.
Exactly. Now, he is not a saint by any standard. He's called it sort of jestingly in the same way that people used to say that Satan was the patron saint of attorneys. Don't worry, my husband's a retired attorney, but he's asleep, so don't worry. But
okay, I'm not worried.
Actually was known as a demon. His name actually sometimes comes up even in medieval religious plays as someone who will tempt you off the straight and narrow. Because then, of course, you'll make mistakes and he will collect your mistakes to bring to his evil master.
I do have
a comment, but I'd like to sing this song first. This is actually a song written by Bill Hildebrandt from the point of view of a medieval monk telling of his battle with this demon once he sees it. After the song, I do not really think that the method the monk used, although it's the historically attested method that they told you to use to keep away the demon of error, I don't really think it's the best method. And after the song, if you ask me nicely, I will tell you in three words what I think is at least as effective, or will at least make his method work a lot better. So, who of us knows The Thing? If you are a certain age, you'll remember a song whose tune is called The Thing. Some of it know it as The Lincolnshire Poacher. And I think you know it. And if you don't know the title, you'll know the tune once you hear it. Okay. 'Twas in the middle of the night, a week or so ago, I heard a strange and ghostly noise out in my studio. I went downstairs and opened the door, and much to my surprise, I saw Titivolus standing there right before my eyes. I looked at him and he looked at me. Scroll up. And he said not a word. But I was sure it was this beast that made the noise I heard. I said, "Get out, you devil!" But my voice he just ignored. And then he started splashing ink all over my drawing board. Well, he poured ink on my layouts and my finished pieces, too. He left the top of my drawing board all covered up with glue. He emptied my paints and broke my pens. And then he said with glee, "Well, that was fun, but I've just begun. What else do you have for me?" Oh, I tried to catch the devil, but his magic was too strong. He flipped from here to there and never stayed in one place long. And then I remembered something that I'd heard long years ago. I thought I'd try it to see if I could make that devil go. Well, I took two pencils in my hand and held them like a cross. Now the devils don't like the deity, and it showed him who was boss. So I walked right toward him with that cross held high above my head, and Titivulus gave an awful cry, enough to raise the dead. He backed into a corner, and right there before my eyes, he put down my ink and started to shrink into a smaller size. Smaller and smaller he got until he vanished from my sight. And that was the last of Titivulus I saw that awful night. But, scribes, now let me warn you, this devil's still around. He'll ruin your work before your eyes and never make a sound. So do your work the best you can and lock your ink up tight and pray that Titivulus never comes to visit you at night. Now, there's another remedy that'll keep this beast at bay. It's a Latin phrase that every one of you must learn to say. Abi in malam crucem are the words, don't get them wrong. They mean Titivulus, go to the devil, that's where you belong. Now, okay. My comment is that, you know, Latin prayers and crosses and things are all very well, as I'm not a Christian. I do not think they'd work for me. But my advice to everyone has been, you know, whatever else you may go into in terms of prayers, devotion, meditation, symbolism, what I say is if this devil is in your life, your best solution is in three words: exercise your handwriting.
Okay.
So that's, you'll notice that he actually does use that solution, but he seems to put a lot more faith in, you know, the devotional exercises sort of thing. Well, let's see. Okay, now actually, I did go sort of out of order here, so I'm going to turn to, okay, the Calligrapher's Blues. Who likes your good old standard 12-bar blues that has a million different variants? Because not everything in life of a scribe is, you know, sunshine and rainbows and chasing away demons, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Let's go for the Calligrapher's Blues. I'm not very good at singing blues, but I'll try. I put my pen on the paper, but the words don't seem to flow. Yes, my pen's on the paper, but the words don't seem to flow. Now my ink's dried up and I'm feeling mighty low. I've got those Calligrapher's Blues as I'm standing here tonight. I've got those Calligrapher's Blues as I'm standing here tonight. Wrote that page 11 times and I still can't get it right. I'd rather spill ink on my paper and break my pen in two. Rather spill ink on my paper and break my pen in two than to write fancy letters if the words they spell ain't true. Well, there's 6 and 20 letters, there's nothing they can't spell. Yes, there's 6 and 20 letters, there's nothing they can't spell. Words like love and heaven, words like hate and hell. I've written all those letters from A right through to Z. Yes, all those pretty letters from A right through to Z. But there isn't anybody writes pretty letters for me. Now I can write with a flourish. I can read between the lines. I can write with a flourish. I can read between the lines. And I know the road to heaven. I don't need any fancy road signs. I've got gold leaf on my letters, got silver in my hair. Yes, there's gold leaf on my letters, there's silver in my hair. I've wasted half a lifetime and I'm damned if I know where. It's those Calligrapher's Blues I'm singing about tonight. Those Calligrapher's Blues I'm singing about tonight. Wrote that page 11 times and it still don't come out right.
Okay.
You like this now. Another song of being miserable. Little different musical idiom, but I think we have much the same concerns as our blues singer over there. Go back. My ballpoint. For all those who think who cannot be calligraphers or have tried and it has not worked. Let's see what we can do with this. My fountain, you'll know the tune right away. My fountain pen leaks in my pocket. My italics a horror to see. My copper plate's just an abortion. Oh, bring back my ballpoint to me. Yes, it's my Bonnie Lies Over the Ocean. Bring back my ballpoint to me. Bring back my ballpoint to me. I took a great course with Herr Heffer. His brushwork was something to see. But he cried when he looked at my paper. Oh, bring back my ballpoint to me. Bring back my ballpoint to me. Bring back my ballpoint to me. Cool Monet tried teaching me Neuland. She said, hold your arm just like me. I did, and I got tennis elbow. Oh, bring back my ballpoint to me. Bring back my ballpoint to me. Bring back my ballpoint to me. Ward Dunham I've always admired, and I finally met him, you see. When we shook hands, he broke all my fingers. Oh, bring back my ballpoint to me. Bring back my ballpoint to me. Bring back my ballpoint to me. They taught me to use handmade paper and rare inks from over the sea. This hobby's put me in the poorhouse. Oh, bring back my ballpoint to me. Bring back. Oh, bring back my ballpoint to me. Bring back. Oh, bring back my ballpoint to me. Calligraphy's just an illusion. All those beautiful letters you see, I think they just do them with mirrors. Oh, bring back my ballpoint to me. Bring back my ballpoint to me. Bring back. Oh, bring back my ballpoint to me. I was showing a customer samples. My ink bottle I did not see. I spilled it all over my client. Oh, bring back my ballpoint to me. Bring back. Bring back my ballpoint to me. Bring back. Bring back my ballpoint to me. I applied for a job doing letters. Some examples they wanted to see. I showed them the best of my samples. Then they gave back my ballpoint to me. Bring back my ballpoint to me. Bring back. Oh, bring back my ballpoint to me. Oh, give me a pen with no angles and a paper with lines I can see. Then transport me back to my childhood and bring back my ballpoint to me. Bring back my ballpoint to me. Bring back my ballpoint to me. I hope you all feel that way. You ever feel that way, Aya, when you're practicing? Maybe copying some, I don't know if you do calligraphy, but when you're copying a script in some language you're studying, like Chinese, you're copying some script you learned about in archaeology. Do you ever think, I'm never going to do this?
Oh, sure. I'm terrible. I have terrible handwriting. But I'm wondering if that ballpoint was a Parker. What do you think?
It might have been. It might not have been. Parker makes ballpoints, but they made other types. They made fountain pens before they made ballpoints.
I know.
I suspect that it could have been any pen. It might have been a cheap one because someone who craves a ballpoint Well, some people like high quality ballpoints, but most people who want a ballpoint, they don't care about what they're writing with. They just want to pick up a pen. Actually, I would like to take a minute and sing a very brief song. I don't know the author, not from Bill Hildebrandt. I learned this anonymously. I have slightly cleaned up a bit of the lyrics to make it at least marginally safe for work and the underage to listen to. And since it mentions Parker in part of the song, and since it's somewhat about someone doing something with a pen that really oughtn't to be done with a pen, I think I will venture it. Okay, and I don't have a tune for this one unless the tune is the first line. Mary from the mountain glen had escapades with a fountain pen. The top went off, the ink went wild, and she gave birth to a bright blue child. They called the baby Parker. They called the baby Parker. They called the baby Parker, 'cause that was the name of the ink. Quink, quink. Okay. Well, you brought up Parker, and as you know, Parker's ink brand is named Quink. Their fountain pen ink. You know, I don't know if they have a name for their ballpoint ink.
Yeah.
Well, okay, so there was something not by Bill Hildebrandt, but not by me either. I think Mary from the Mountain Glen would have been rather well advised to take a little more care with how she used that pen of hers.
Oh, yes.
She might have wanted to listen to this little teaching song by Bill Hildebrandt to the tune of Button Up Your Overcoat called Do Calligraphy. I don't know if I have it there. If I don't, I should have. So scroll down. And if it's not there, I'll sing it anyway. Okay?
Okay. Just a moment. Let me see if I can scroll down.
Well, we don't. We're going to get to this one. Let's see. Scroll down. If it's not there. Oh, I'm not. It's not there. Scroll back. Some of them I simply forgot to copy, and I do apologize. But you're going to like this. It might have ended up somewhere else. But I'll tell you, if you want to see this book back in print, I think our only way to do it is for us all to go to Amazon and do as I have done. I think you go there, go down to where it says, I'd like to see this book on Kindle, because what happens then is either they track down the publisher and try to talk the publisher into doing it, or if they can't find the publisher, they find some way to get someone to do it as a Kindle book once they find that the rights have been abandoned. But they could find Connecticut Valley Calligraphers. They could find the publisher because, you know, normally, okay, W.J. Hildebrandt, he did apparently leave some people behind, even though he's gone and his business is gone. And I think if this book was back in, it gives you some very interesting things to copy, and you can see what
you would
work.
Just need to find the heirs.
We could do this one, but I'd rather do one that I left out.
Okay.
Because I think this is Do Calligraphy to the tune of Button Up Your Overcoat. Write some verses every day, one or two or three. Get your pen and get your ink. Do calligraphy. Learn your Gothic capitals. Try an until D. Get your pen and get your ink. Do calligraphy. When you write copperplate, oh, oh, let your pen skate. Oh, oh, don't hesitate. Oh, oh, you'll catch your nib and splatter your paper. Keep away from ballpoint pens, I know that you'll agree. Get your pen and get your ink. Do calligraphy. Learn another alphabet. Write from A to Z. Get your pen and get your ink. Do calligraphy. If you spill ink on your page, baby, c'est la vie. Get your pen and get your ink. Do calligraphy. Be careful crossing T's. Oh, oh, writing C's. Oh, oh, gilding E's. Oh, oh, you'll press too hard and ruin your gesso. When you work for other folks, make sure you charge a fee. Get your pen and get your ink. Do calligraphy. And now it's time for what is one of the very few songs from, you know, Bill Hildebrandt they know by heart.
Which one?
That blooms in the spring. This is one okay. Well, let's go up to where that was, because yes, I did get out of order. I had some trouble with copying and pasting when I was doing this. But if you all love the flowers that bloom in the spring from the Mikado, I think we've all heard that, right? I think you're very much a Gilbert and Sullivan person. Am I right?
Well, most of my friends are, so I do know the songs.
You know it good. Okay. I happen to be one, and not everyone has to be, but you'll like this, I think. The flourish that blooms in the spring, tra-la. The flourish that blooms in the spring. The flourish that blooms in the spring, tra-la. You all know the pleasure it brings, tra-la. It makes your calligraphy sing. Yes, it makes your calligraphy sing. When you write a Z and extend the last stroke, make it curl, make it swirl like a thin wisp of smoke. It's not just a letter, it's something much better. It's the flourish that blooms in the spring. It's not just a letter, it's something much better. The flourish that blooms in the spring.
Okay. Wonderful. Yes.
Hope you like that. I think that's...
I did.
Flourishing, it looks easy. It's hard. For me, it's hard. For him, Bill Hildebrandt, I think it was easy. Let's scroll down. Let's go down. I've got the book, so I can always flip back and forth. I meant these to be in order. They're not, because I ended up saying I want them to follow some kind of sequence. So let's scroll down or scroll up if we have to. We've got a few more coming. Okay, Viva Calligraphy. We all know Viva L'Amour, right? Okay, this song he apparently sang at his group, and it mentions some famous calligraphers. It tells you a little about them, so you won't be too totally lost as you hear this, even though you don't know these folks. Okay?
Okay.
Oh, oh, come all ye scribes and join in the song. Viva calligraphy. Success to our fellows and help them along. Viva calligraphy. Viva la, la plume. Viva la, viva la plume. Viva la plume. Viva la plume. Viva calligraphy. The name of our club is a long one, and how. Viva calligraphy. Connecticut Valley calligraphers, wow. Viva calligraphy. Viva la, viva la plume. Viva la, viva la, viva la plume. Viva la plume. Viva la plume. Viva calligraphy. The Pope said, Origi, please give me a hand. Viva calligraphy. So he gave him italic, and isn't it grand? Viva calligraphy. Viva la, viva la, viva la plume. Viva la, viva la, viva la plume. Viva la plume. Viva la plume. Viva calligraphy. Ed Johnston's italic grew pointed and black. Viva calligraphy. But he knew that his letters were on the right track. Viva calligraphy. Viva la, viva la, viva la plume. Viva la, viva la, viva la plume. Viva la plume. Viva la plume. Viva calligraphy. Take Vanstone and Drogan, those medieval years. Viva calligraphy. You'd think they were born in the medieval years. Viva calligraphy. Viva la, viva la, viva la plume. Viva la, viva la, viva la plume. Viva la plume. Viva la plume. Viva calligraphy. Our editor made our newsletter look swell. Viva calligraphy. And next time he says, he will learn how to spell. Viva calligraphy. Viva la, viva la, viva la plume. Viva la, viva la, viva la plume. Viva la plume, viva la plume. Viva calligraphy. Fracture was current when times were baroque. Viva calligraphy. That's when they put flourishes on every stroke. Viva la calligraphy. Viva la, viva la, viva la plume. Viva calligraphy. Viva la, viva la, viva la plume. Viva la plume, viva la plume. Viva calligraphy. The modern calligraphers taught us to twist. Viva calligraphy. There isn't a pen angle that they have missed. Viva calligraphy. Viva la, viva la, viva la plume. Viva la, viva la, viva la plume. Viva la plume. Viva la plume. Viva calligraphy. Carl Georg Hofer does brushwork with style. Viva calligraphy. He sharpens his brush with a 14-inch file. Viva calligraphy. Viva la, viva la, viva la plume. Viva la, viva la, viva la plume. Viva la plume, viva la plume, viva calligraphy. We heard Peter Thornton explaining fine art. Viva calligraphy. He can put it together or take it apart. Viva calligraphy. Viva la, viva la, viva la plume. Viva la, viva la, viva la plume. Viva la plume, viva la plume, viva calligraphy. Now you know the song. You can write your own verse. Viva calligraphy. Let's hope they are better than these and not worse. Viva calligraphy. Viva la, viva la, viva la plume. Viva la, viva la, viva la plume. Viva la plume. Viva la plume. Viva calligraphy. Now we've got some. Have we got some others? Probably. Yes, we have one. And this is a little consolation for the calligrapher's blue, you know, artist. And for if you sympathize with the calligrapher's blues or you want your ballpoint again, this one is for you. Okay, well, this one also, we could do this one. We'll do this one, and then we'll do something else. Okay. I've been working on the railroad. Naturally becomes I've been working on my drawing board all the livelong day. I've been working on my drawing board just to pass the time away. Can't you see that I've been writing using a paper by the ream? Can't you see it so exciting? Sometimes I could scream. Do it over once, do it over twice, do it over three times, ain't that nice? Do it over once, do it over twice, do it over one more time. Someone's at the door with an order. Someone's at the door, I know. Someone's at the door with an order, gonna charge him lots of dough. Singing C-A-L-L-I-G-R-A-P-H-Y-I-I-I-C-A-L-L-I-G-R-A-P-H-Y. And now you'll never forget how to spell the word calligraphy. Remember, I promised I'd make sure that I'd bring you a song that would teach you how to spell it. Now you know.
Thank you.
So let's go on. Let's see, because I know I went and scanned a few more things in here. So let's go on. Let's see what surprises. Wait, I mean, you know how sometimes you put something in the word processor, you save it. Sometimes if you're posting in a graphic, here's something very, very short on a calligraphic style that's not shown here, but that we should do a show about because we should do some shows in calligraphic styles. Okay. And this is the style that is often associated with Ireland, even though that was far from the only country where it was ever used or was well loved and known. When Irish eyes are smiling, when uncial letters are smiling. And if you want to know what uncials are, well, there's a link. You can look them up. You'll probably like them. When the uncial hand I'm writing, short is like a morning spring. With those Celtic letters flowing, you can hear the angels sing. And when uncial letters are flourished, with those knots and beasts so gay, then those uncial letters are smiling and they steal your heart away. Now, before we go to the next one, which is rather long, I would like to enclose, I would like to do one that I don't think I included here, but a lot of people like it, especially, you know, how there's a saying about Christmas in July. Well, there's one nice little thing he wrote. That he wrote to, of all things, the tune of Jingle Bells. So, and I am not a Christmassy person, but there are enough people who think that Christmas in July is a thing that, well, it's still July, so we can do this. Calligraphy, calligraphy, writing all the way. Oh, what fun it is to use my pen and ink today. Calligraphy, calligraphy, let the rafters ring. If it weren't for calligraphy, I'd have no song to sing. Stroking across the page with my brand new Osmeroid. The letter forms are great, and I am overjoyed. The X is 5 nips tall, the sender's just 5 more. This page is turning out to be a page that I'll adore. Oh, calligraphy, calligraphy, writing all the way. Oh, what fun it is to use my pen and ink today. Hey, calligraphy, calligraphy, let the rafters ring. If it weren't for calligraphy, I'd have no song to sing. Halfway down the page, an idea came to me. I'd put a fancy flourish into ornament a T. My arm was nice and loose. I'd done this quite a lot. But the paper caught my pen edge, and oh, damn, I got a blot. Oh, calligraphy, calligraphy, writing all the way. Oh, what fun it is to write my pen and use my pen and ink today. Oh, calligraphy, calligraphy, let the rafters ring. If it weren't for calligraphy, I'd have no song to sing. I started thinking hard. The sheet is what's my last. The paper was expensive and I had to fix it fast. I drew some petals on the blot and then a stem below. A lovely black chrysanthemum. Now no one will ever know. Now this song is, by the way, a little dated. You can no longer get a brand new Osmeroid because the Osmeroid Fountain Pen Company went out of business sometime between the time this book was written And now it's been out of business for longer than some of the younger scribes have been alive, which is sad because it was a very good company. I mean, you can buy new old stock used ones on eBay, but, you know, you got to be careful with them because there will not be more where these come from unless someone buys out the old name and starts up the company. Now, the Order of the Black Chrysanthemum actually is a thing. There actually are some lettering groups, calligraphy guilds and the like, that actually give some of their members as a sort of joke membership with a little parchment certificate and everything in something called the Order of the Black Chrysanthemum, that being, of course, the ink blot. I don't know how one qualifies, as I've never been offered this, although I've made enough blots and other errors that I probably deserve one, but, you know, no one, but I am not part of the calligraphy club scene for various reasons. There just doesn't seem to be such a scene up here in Albany where I've lived for so long and just not enough calligraphers to form a critical mass. But the Order of the Black Chrysanthemum is a thing, and people, and I do know or have known people who've gotten them. And I'm actually going to take a minute before we go, scroll down, and this way we can end with a fun one. But before that, I want to see if Order of the Black Chrysanthemum is in Wikipedia, because if it was, hey, maybe they would tell me how to get a certificate of my very own. And I think most of us have made ink blots in our lives, which I presume to be the major qualification that then we can end. And we have some links about Bill Hildebrandt, and I would say look them up. I want to see. Order of the Black Chrysanthemum. Come on. Sometimes I get no results for things I know darn well are in there. Okay, I'm going to try third time lucky. And then we're going to maybe, if not close out the evening, at least close out the musical portion and then maybe talk a little. But now I want to take one more time looking for the Order of the Black Chrysanthemum. Let's see. Actually, no, there's a Supreme Order of the Chrysanthemum, which is Japan's highest award. Oh, actually, there is. Apparently, it is now a subsidiary of the Portland Society for Calligraphy, and I know people who are in that society. It's one of the oldest and best. If you Google the Order of the Black Chrysanthemum, Portland Society, it will come up, and you'll see their logo and their pretty calligraphy. If you want to if you want to take a moment before we close out the evening, go on the internet to portlandsocietyforcalligraphy.org/the Order of the Black Chrysanthemum. No, I don't have to make it hard for you. I could add this in later. I hate to give dictation, so I'm going to see if I can get there. Here's what I'm going to do for you guys. I'm going for you, Aya, and anyone else who's watching. I copy the URL. I'm going to open Notes, paste it into Notes in their horrible little type font, and put that on the screen. And you will be able to take a screenshot, and then you can go there and come on. Okay, this way,
I have part of that. Is this?
Well, I'll tell you what else. What I'll do is I'll send it to you after the show. If you were able to stop the screen sharing and get your camera on, you could get a screenshot and then everybody could go. And then you could get back and I could sing the very last song. How about that?
Okay, how about we just go ahead and sing the song?
All right. I'll send you the link afterwards because I'm curious myself. Okay. And this is yet another one, obviously, that he did for his club. Was it the last one in the book? Yup, it actually was. Hinky Dinky Parley-Voo naturally becomes Inky Dinky Parley-Voo, where Connecticut Valley calligraphers parley-voo, where Connecticut Valley calligraphers parley-voo, where Connecticut Valley calligraphers, we've got some hymns and a lot of hers. Inky Dinky Parley-Voo. We make our ink from berries and roots, parley-voo. We make our ink from berries and roots, parley-voo. We make our ink from berries and roots, and we carve our pens from bamboo shoots. Inky, dinky, parlez-vous. Our pens don't slip, our inks don't smear, parlez-vous. Our pens don't slip, our inks don't smear, parlez-vous. Our pens don't slip, our inks don't smear, and don't believe everything you hear. Inky, dinky, parlez-vous. Those Roman capitals are the rage, parlez-vous. Those Roman capitals are the rage, parlez-vous. Those Roman capitals are the rage. Mine are Roman all over the page. Inky, dinky, parlez-vous. We're the best there is with pen and ink, parlez-vous. The best there is with pen and ink, parlez-vous. The best there is with pen and ink. Well, that's what we let our clients think. Inky, dinky, parlez-vous. Our flourishes are smooth as silk, parlez-vous. Our flourishes are smooth as silk, parlez-vous. Our flourishes are smooth as silk. We never spill ink, but only milk. Inky, dinky, parlez-vous. We always get every letter right, parlez-vous. We always get every letter right, parlez-vous. We always get every letter right, although it may take us all day or night and night. Inky, dinky, parlez-vous. I'm pretty sure that song, that the source song, probably is a story in Wikipedia also. I may look it up one of these days, because I've heard that it's older than World War II, that there's an earlier version, actually back to the time of King Charles of England. I have never, well, Hinky Dinky Parlez-Vous, actually, well, it was composed in 1924, but apparently it had some earlier roots. I've heard claims that there was a version of the time, you know, a long time before that. Have never been able to verify it. But anyway, I do hope you have enjoyed this.
Oh, yes.
I hope I haven't been terribly boring. And by the way, I would love to help you get a little closer to replicating the handwriting of your choice, even if it's one I don't know. If I could see you write on camera, I might be able to give you some hints on technique if I saw the model you were copying, you know, the inscription or whatever, and watch you produce your efforts. I might have some tips as to how to get the lines to go where you want them to go.
Well, right now I'm actually struggling with how to create images. So I've been painting rather than writing, so to speak. Yeah.
I've seen. Well, it will help, actually. Drawing and painting do help many people's handwriting and vice versa. I would very much like it if we could do an episode where basically I help you cope with basically whatever you pull out that I could take a look at and see how it's supposed to look and see your efforts and see what I could do to help you. After all, it might be helpful to other people. We have people here whose native languages use a variety of writing systems, whom I know to this, and maybe they could get some help struggling with whatever they're struggling with if they're learning English as a second language. You might want to think of it.
I got these new brushes, so.
Yeah, I would. Oh, Russian. Well, very nice. Very good array of brushes. Well, and we could certainly do some brush lettering. It's not my, it's not my specialty, but there are techniques that can be learned. And, you might want to consider, as you get more comfortable with brushes, you might consider doing paintings and having some objects that have writing on them in the paintings.
I can't even spell my name on the painting yet. So as you know, I make the Aleph like this, and then I make the Kaf like that.
I could probably help you with some of that, even though it might be arrogance on my part to help an Israeli. But let's just say that I might be able to pass on a trick or two to you. Sometimes it does help to, well, let's just say there are things that not everyone knows about how to get some coherence between one stroke and the next within a letter or word. And maybe I could, give you a little performance tip. We can see about that. Now, I don't know what we have scheduled for next month. August.
I thought we were going to do something about cuneiform.
Except I was never able to get a response from, you know, anyone who knew anything about it. So, and I do not know much about cuneiform. I do know a little, but I do not think that I'm the right person to speak about it. This may be time for you to find another guest speaker. There's bound to be someone at some nearby college or university who knows archaeology, who knows a bit about cuneiform, and who could talk. And this time we would be just the eager students.
Well, I mean, it would be wonderful if we could schedule someone like that, but I can't promise.
If you can, well, here's what I can do. If we're bound and determined to do cuneiform, I will go and work up some of my reading, because one of the few things I do know is that a lot of the stuff that survives from that era is literally schoolwork that was written by children or teens learning.
Oh, I would love to do that.
Mostly boys, and there were schools for it. Some girls learned it too if their family, you know, was of high status, but they did not go to school. If you were a girl, you had to learn at home. They weren't going to send you to mix with the boys, I suppose. But anyway, I could probably look up, I think I can do fun things you never knew about cuneiform, although we will find a better title.
Okay, and that we'll sounds put it wonderful. Up. That's what we'll do at the very end of August. Now, next Friday, as you know, we are going to do the Rondo form with composer Daniel Carter, but we do have something that you wrote that will be featured in that program.
Yes, indeed. And I'll see if I can tune in. I will tell you, I don't get know of my all of my schedule for August. I may have to go and I may not be available. It depends on what is coming up. I may have to leave town to sign some paperwork, basically stuff dealing with money and debts and things that, you know, my late mother left, as you know, she passed last month, and the three the three surviving children, myself, my brother, and my sister, are basically, at some point, we'll all have to go and sign some papers, basically for some money stuff, and I would tell you, but it's boring, you know, and at some point, it may be that I will need to take off a weekend and be in New York City, and since I basically have to go by, you know, majority rules. We agreed that deciding who was going to do what when was going to be majority rule as far as legally possible. So if they say that I have that the last weekend in August is when I have to be up, well, that takes out that Friday because I would have to get in before. You know,
okay,
if
I'm told that
we're
going to
need you Friday afternoon or Monday morning, if that happens, I will let you know. And if that happens, what I will try to do will be to get together notes. And then you can do the show and show these funny things and these cool facts that I will gather for you to show. Okay?
Okay, that sounds wonderful. And I really did enjoy your singing and your presentation today.
Thank you so much. And perhaps you will write some songs and we could jointly write them. Because I'm thinking maybe a way to get this back into print would be to write some songs, have a songbook, and then approach the late Bill Hildebrandt's old guild, which is still in business, and say, can we reissue his book and have it as a series together with our book? They might say yes, they might say no. But if they said no, well, you yourself are a publisher and we could then do it. We could then at least do our songs and then maybe you might get the rights to reprint his.
That sounds like a plan.
Because that way, if you can reprint his and have a two-volume set or something, super. But they may not let you do it, but at least we'll have ours. You know that there are things you've written and I've written. I think that you would be capable of writing things. After all, you wrote that whole series, Vacuum County, which, although it's set in Texas, was actually inspired by things from archaeology and the Bible, sort of the more cool and weird parts of the Bible, the parts you don't get to hear in Sunday school, I think. And if you could write all that, you could probably write some funny songs.
I already wrote Filker's Fate, which is a Filk of Harriet's Ford. And you've heard that before, right?
I'm trying to remember.
What words are these that sound like mine, an echo of your your songs.
Maybe. I've heard that. Yeah, I don't know, but I have heard it. But I would say, given your background in archaeology, in pre-Abrahamic religions, in, you know, all sorts of cultures of the Near East and elsewhere, I think I have often thought it would be good to write an album that showed someone's journey through history as someone learning, you know, learning the alphabet. In other words, what if the alphabet itself, or people who'd invented it or invented some writing system, could sing it? I mean, wouldn't it be wonderful? I suspect it would be wonderful if there could be, what if there could be, I mean, have you ever thought of writing a song or a group of songs from the point of view of the slaves in the Sinai desert who were adapting cuneiform to make their own system, not cuneiform, I mean hieroglyphs, to make their own system by repurposing some of the hieroglyph symbols to stand for sounds?
Yeah, well, we don't know exactly how that came
yeah.
about.
Well, you could conjecture and write about the conjecture, write about the different ones. I mean,
what I think is interesting is the change in the shapes of the letters.
Yes.
That occurred as a result in changes in their lifestyle. So, for instance, yeah. the Bet or the Dalet.
Yeah. Now that would be interesting to write a song. You know, how does something that looked like a tent start looking like a house? Yeah. That sort of thing.
Yeah.
Now, what I also think is interesting to me as a writer, you know, a handwriting teacher and calligrapher, is that some of the changes, at least those that happened, going from the Paleo Hebrew script to the current script that is used, some of them appear to have been the results of going from writing on stone and clay and potsherds to writing with, you know, reed pens on, you know, papyrus and later parchment, in terms of wanting some of the strokes to sort of flow into other strokes. Now, in fact, when we, you know, at some point we might want to talk a little bit about the Hebrew alphabet, which we did once, but I'm going to mention something which will mean something to you, not something to those listening who, unless they know Hebrew and know how to write it, but I think you'll see the point. Now, if you know the history of our alphabet, as you do, you will know that the Paleo Hebrew Samech and the modern Hebrew Samech are about as different from one another as any two shapes could possibly be. Whereas the modern Samech is a circle or oval, you know, depending which hand writing. The Paleo Hebrew Samech looks like nothing so much as a barbecue grid, a vertical with three horizontals. Now, I will have to demonstrate to you sometime. One time, I'll have to pull up my trusty whiteboard or some paper, you know, and I'll have to, but how did this ever happen? It was a bit of a mystery until archaeologists found on places like the Elephantine Island, you know, in Medinat Habu in Egypt, where they found various groups of Jews, the Jewish garrison of mercenaries. They found documents and they found, believe it or not, intermediate forms. They found you would have this, you know, crossbars and then this vertical line. And you start seeing two crossbars and one. And then you started seeing the crossbar going down and moving up and creating the other side, which had been the vertical. So at one point, there was a two-stroke samech where you had the top, the right side, and then a line to close it with the left side. You still have the calligraphically, but now it's usually one. And once you see it happen, it makes sense. It's bizarre, but it makes sense. You don't have to just sit there and say, this is a Samech from the time of King David, because my archaeology book said back then this was the Samech. You can see how we got from there to here. And, you know, someone should really write the book. And if you want a book, read Paleo Hebrew Fast. You and I could do that together.
Okay. Yeah, that's...
We'd have to call it something else, you know, but we'd have to call it something like How We Got From There to Here. And yeah. I think we have to write it in English and leave it to you to translate into Hebrew, because Israel would have a much bigger market for it. But I think that's people who are learning Hebrew here, you know, Jewish people and even non-Jews who study biblical Hebrew for purposes of their own faith.
People all over the world right now.
I know, but since in Israel, where people love archaeology,
I am sure, you know, I am sure that there are people who wonder, you know, how did we get from here to there? You know, some of the changes are very, very obvious. You can see how it happened. Okay, you mentioned bet, the letter whose name means house in archaic Hebrew. One of the things that happens with a pen is that strokes that were once multiple become single. So instead of the top of the bet being a pointy triangle thing, you end up with just one stroke because, you know, you're a busy man and, you know, a pen on what amounts to paper, okay, papyrus or parchment, wants to move much more than it, you know, than a pointed stick being dug.
Yeah, but you know, an earlier form, before it looked like that tent thing, it looked like a square, which made me think it was maybe a hut, you know, like a mud hut.
Now, you're probably right because it looks like one of the Egyptian hieroglyphs for house, which was a floor plan of a rather typical type of Egyptian house. You know, you have some walls and you have the entry, and it looks, in other words, and obviously if you are in Egypt, but Egyptian is not your mother tongue, and you get the idea of writing things down, you may look for shapes to borrow. Now, you know, one of the conjectures
it might be that they were living in a house shaped that way.
Very
but then after a while, they were living in a tent. So
certainly,
rather than changing the name of the letter, they changed
the shape to look like, look like the one they can relate to. But I would also say that when you talk about, you know, when people have often just wondered about, well, how does someone get the idea of having signs for sounds anyway, when all through humankind, as far as people had ever picked up anything to make a mark on anything, they had done things that represented words or ideas or, you know, symbols or concepts.
Look, and it's because the Semitic language is very consonant based.
Yes.
And it's okay. Because
The cooler things was, but like, why this group of people? After all, the Egyptians had slaves from many groups of people, many of whom spoke other languages in which consonants were.
It's not clear that it happened in Egypt. Okay?
It's not, of course, it's not clear. But one of the theories has been that since some of these inscriptions are literally things put on the walls by the miners, and since, as Leslie Fish, our mutual friend, once pointed out to me, no matter what language they're in, no matter what language they're in, once they're deciphered, it's not just through the language or the writing system they can tell which ones were written by Hebrews and which ones were written by Egyptians. The Egyptian workers seem to have been treated a bit better than. In other words, let's just say one group of inscriptions says things like, please, God, help us. And one group will have things more like, Stonecutter Gang number 42, Pharaoh's Pals, we rule, or for a good time, see Muba, Blue Door, Street of Joy, fourth floor up, you know? And in other words, and it's possible if you have an oppressed group, a marginalized group, one of the things you want to do is make a secret code.
Okay, you are getting,
far afield.
Yeah.
But one of the theories is that it was created as a code.
The Hebrew-speaking people included all of the Canaanites.
Well, will bow to your superior expertise there. I only want you to know that one of the theories, as a code, that it would have been useful. In other words, an Egyptian would look at this and just say, oh, they've got hieroglyphs, but they're not even making any sense. They're just random. Oh, look, you know, as in,
it didn't start in Egypt. It started.
Well enough. If it didn't, but remember, since at one point it was, the Egyptians might have seen it and might have thought it was nothing. These are stupid people pretending they can write when it really would have been a writing system. Is the point. Because if you're a marginalized person, one of the best things you can have is a writing system that your boss doesn't know is a writing system.
You're a Jew. You identify with marginalized people because you think of the Jewish people as marginalized.
Well, I don't really. I identify with marginalized people because I've been kicked around. Heck, I was kicked around before I knew I was Jewish. So it's not quite that.
What I'm saying is that the Hebrew language has a glorious history.
Yes.
Way before anybody got marginalized.
It certainly does. It was mostly known as the language of Canaan before anyone called it Hebrew or anything. And
the point is,
I think about marginalized people basically because I've been kicked around. Look, I was kicked around before I knew that there was such a thing as Jewish or had ever heard the word applied to me or anything.
Okay. What I'm saying is we don't have to.
We don't have to argue about
them.
It. Okay.
Yeah.
It's just all I want to point out that there are conjectures. There are reasons to believe or not believe in many of them. Whatever, it's good that we have it.
Yes.
That's all I want to say.
Yes. Anyway, we have it.
Let's see if we can have some fun with cuneiform next month. Okay.
Okay. Thank you very much. And
Thank
have a
you.
Nice evening. Good
Thank
night.
Goodbye.